Welcome back to the show. Well, forget fear of missing out. The property market is now in the grips of a new kind of FOMO, paralysing both buyers and sellers.
Experts are calling it fear of making a mistake. And for more, we're joined by Domain property editor Alice Stoltz in Melbourne. Alice, good morning. What exactly does fear of making a mistake mean?
Good morning, guys. Look, we saw FOMO really fueled prices during the last phase of the hot market in 20 to 2022. And then, of course, we saw fear of overpaying, where buyers were so worried about paying too much when prices started to decline. And now we're in this sort of situation where buyers and sellers are both kind of bewildered, I suppose, and feeling like deer in the headlights when it comes to actually making a decision about whether to buy or sell now with all the volatility that is surrounding the market and the economy.
So what does it look like for both sides?
Look, Carl, I think for buyers what it means is that they're just literally kind of sitting back in their seats thinking, I don't want to overpay, I don't know what interest rates are going to do, are we going to go into a recession, what's going to happen with inflation? And I think for sellers there's also the pressure of them thinking what's going to happen with prices, as well as not quite feeling confident that if they do sell successfully, they will actually be able to find a new property to move into.
So instead of dwelling on those concerns, what should people be focusing on instead?
I think, Sarah, it's really important to sort of step back from it all and understand that really when you look at it, it's time in the market that's going to count here, not timing the market. Mm. Now, when we look historically at what's happened over the market, you can see that upswings go for much longer than downturns. So we're not quite sure if we're completely out of the downturn. Now we are in a recovery phase, but that's going to depend on what interest rates do next and the economy. But you can see that upswings really do go a lot longer than a downturn. And also percentage-wise of the growth during those periods is starkly different. You can see in our most recent upswing, we saw growth of 33.6%, whereas the downturn was only 0.9%. And even historically, when you go back to 95 even, you can see that those upswings are much longer. So the good times last longer, and the kind of crash and burn thing that people worry about in property is actually not as profound when you look back at it overall.
Gee, it'd be bullshit to punch into a 6% mortgage though now, wouldn't
it?
I mean, especially if you're starting from scratch.
And that's what I think is happening, Carl. People are just literally in this state of paralysis at the moment.
Yeah.
But we know that rates are probably going to remain high for quite some time. Mm. Even if we don't get another rise, they are going to be at this level for quite a long period.
All right. Good on you, Alice. Thank you so much. Always nice to see you. Well, a major political roadblock continues to stand between struggling Aussies and affordable housing.
The government and the Greens will try and work a deal to solve the crisis, but no one is holding their breath. As the delays continue, it's Aussies who suffer, just like this family who spoke to A Current Affair last night.
We are living off our friends' couch, mattresses on the floor in our lounge room. It's awful. I wouldn't wish it on my worst enemy. I'm so lost right now that I don't know how to keep going, but I have two beautiful girls to think about at the end of the day, and that keeps us going, always.
It's tough out there. Our next guest is at the grassroots of the housing crisis. Tamika Smith from My Bella Casa on the Gold Coast provides affordable housing solutions. She joins us now. Thanks so much for your time. I mean, you were recently the driving force behind getting Kelly Wilkinson's family a new house built. Where do you reckon they'd have been if they'd waited for government assistance?
If we had to wait currently, we're putting people on a wait list of 10 years
wow.
in our current housing system. Five if it's incredibly urgent, but the statistics show that we're putting people on a 10-year wait list.
Well, there's nothing more being built at the moment, so it's going to be at least that.
Correct. The supply is the major issue. We have a bill proposed to move forward houses, and we're seeing a political peacock fight currently, which is embarrassing when we've got people on the ground that desperately need a house.
Yeah, we just heard from that family, they're sleeping on the couch of friends' places. I mean, what kinds of calls are you receiving from people? How desperate is it out there?
Families just like that. We're seeing elderly women that are being kicked out of their house because a subsidy has been removed and they've got nowhere to go. The embarrassing thing is that we're seeing people make decisions on the front line and in political arenas that aren't privy to these discussions that we're having. Currently, we're not seeing that bill be assessed until at least October nationally, which means that we're looking at potentially a 12-month timeline just to assess this. Mm. If these people are going to take 12 months to assess something like that, perhaps they should give up their house and go live on the streets and see how quickly they can make a decision then.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the frustration level.
Yeah.
I feel like, I mean, we want to highlight these problems, but also on our show we like to at least try and find some solutions. What are they?
We're looking at long-term solutions rather than the short-term strategies that we've seen. We've seen other people in other countries execute that really well, and this is above the political arena. This is a humanity issue. All we're seeing is people look at a short-term supply of 4 years. We'd love to see the houses get out and get on the ground urgently, and we do see a pathway forward with what the government has proposed, but we're seeing people block that at the moment. But we need to look at long-term solutions. We need to look at what happens in 10 years, not just what happens in 4 years when you lose the election.
And that's exactly right. It's all about winning the next election, and that's why everyone thinks politicians are so out of touch. I mean, Tameka, you're seeing these people, you're speaking to them all the time. You're the one that's actually helping fix this problem.
Correct. If you look at the Kelly Wilkinson Solutions, the house that we built for those 8 kids, if you could see the children's faces when they got the safety and security of a new home, that is what every child deserves. Yeah. And it's really sad to see those phone calls come through and we feel powerless to do that, which is why in that example we built that house and we got everyone together within 48 hours, because that was us saying we're done waiting. We're done waiting for people to come to the rescue. We need solutions and we need them now.
We move really quickly at times this nation when people desperately need it, right? But often that's around a national or natural disaster. For example, in Lismore, we've built an incredible facility there relatively quickly. There were some dramas and everything, but we got it done. A well camp, for example, the Wagner's built in Toowoomba. These things can happen.
Yeah.
I just don't know. It can't be a lavish house or anything like that, but we can find a block of land and we can put 100 houses on it, and we can do it really in an expeditious way. What's stopping us from just doing that?
You tell me. I think all we're seeing politically is everyone from an egotistical point of view try and prove that they have a better idea. But the reality is we need houses and we need supply of them urgently. There is no reason that that can't happen quickly. We've executed that ourselves, and the examples that you just gave then, it can happen. So let's get out of the way to make it happen. If not, go sit in a room and work it out until it's done.
Yeah. Very good, Tameka. Yeah. Very good. Let us know what you think about that story, and we'll be following up with Tameka as well. Thank you.
Well, this won't come as much of a surprise, but a record number of Australians are now taking on multiple jobs in order to survive the cost of living crunch. Sydney mum Natasha Piccolo is one of them. She works as a speech pathologist from 9 till 5, but also has two side hustles just to make ends meet. Natasha, her husband Vince, and their son Alfie join us live now from Liverpool in Sydney. Thanks so much for your time, guys. Natasha, you're a full-time speech pathologist, but as the pressure on cost of living increases, it's simply not enough.
Hi, thanks for having us, Sarah. Yeah, I think Vincent and I, my husband, my little family here, we're very grateful that we've got multiple income streams in the current climate that we face the moment with the interest rate rises. We both have, between us, we've actually got 4 businesses.
Wow.
So all businesses were in startup well and truly before the COVID-19 pandemic, but we are so grateful that they are, you know, self-sufficient at the moment, because it really is allowing us to make ends meet.
Well, I guess in a sense you had some incredible foresight there. I mean, these second and third jobs, how important are they for your family budget?
Essentially, it allows us to live relatively comfortably at the moment. And we were just saying the other day, like, we are so grateful for those passive income streams, because, you know, we really honestly don't know how the average Australian is working at the moment. It's getting increasingly difficult.
So even with that extra income coming through,
sure,
to your household, do you,
yep,
still feel the pressure these days as those,
absolutely,
costs mount?
Absolutely. I think in full transparency, like, our 9-to-5s allow us to pay the bills and cover the mortgage, but it's the passive income streams that allow us to have that little bit of life on the side, which, you know, we are very, very aware that it's a luxury at the moment for a lot of Australian families.
And that's the thing. I think the key word there is luxury, because these days it is a luxury, right? I mean, not many people can even have,
yeah,
that. For you, Vince, running the family business, has that been impacted?
It has, because there's, between all the increases from the interest rates, from wages, from cost of goods, it's put a lot of pressure when you're trying to support your team, but you're also trying to ensure that the business doesn't go through tumultuous times.
And that's the thing, isn't it, when you've got staff relying on income too?
Yeah.
Absolutely. I think we felt that pressure the most in the businesses over the pandemic, understandably.
you guys bought your home a few years ago. There have been a number of interest rate hikes since then. How much more pressure does that put on you, obviously paying a mortgage, but then also making sure that your businesses are viable so that you can maintain staff and their ways of living too?
It means that we just need to be more on top of things and more future focused. So
I think financial forecasting has become the mantra in this household at the moment.
Yeah.
Have you had to let anything slide?
Couple subscriptions.
Yeah, all the luxury, the little luxuries, subscription services, streaming services, that kind of thing, just to make it work. And we do have the foresight that it isn't like an interim thing, but it is. It's definitely something we have to work through as a family.
Yeah, absolutely. And maintaining that income to come through to pay the mortgage off and keep the roof on your heads, I guess. A lot of pressure
absolutely.
That everyone's feeling at the moment, guys. Thanks so much for your insight. Appreciate it, Carl.
Sarah, my mum, Jenny, who you know, paid $6 for 5 crumpets yesterday.
Yeah, it's crazy.
$6 a crumpet. I mean, WTF.
OK, let's move on now. And a record number of Australians are working multiple jobs to battle the cost of living crisis. It is getting really bad out there. I mean, Malindiri, nearly a million people have more than one job in this country. It's a massive figure.
Yes, Sarah, and I know that certainly when we came into government, we moved on a number of issues, and one of them came through last month, and that was cheaper childcare. We've certainly looked at support in the area of medications and the distribution of those in people's access to health. We've been ever conscious of those concerns. You know, I am pleased that we haven't seen an increase in terms of the RBA, so that we can see things starting to moderate a bit. We'd no doubt like it to moderate some more, but we are conscious of that. We've certainly increased the minimum wage and also around the care sector in trying to improve the employment prospects around their salaries. Mm. So that's been steps we've taken, but we are conscious that we're watching this closely.
Yeah, well, it is certainly hurting. Anyone who knows, goes to the supermarket knows just how expensive it is to get by these days. I mean, Sophie, so many of us have worked multiple jobs. When I was at uni, I was working at Channel 10 and in retail. But when you add the cost of living pressures we're experiencing now, trying to break into the housing market, people are under a lot of pressure. I mean, you'd be hearing from Australians every day about this. Sure. You know, is wages the issue here? Is it more about whether you can get a roof over your head? It's a multitude of issues, isn't it? Hmm.
I do. I think so. And I think it's all of those things into one, Sarah. And you're right. I mean, I think these figures tell us what we know. But when you drill down into them, you're talking about those people who might have more than one part-time job. My kids, like you, when they were at uni, they've all got multiple jobs just because they're doing a few hours here and a few hours there. I think more broadly, we definitely do hear more about people who would have been considered middle class now feeling like they're really struggling. So there's sort of this slide that's happening. People who didn't necessarily always feel that financial pressure are feeling it now, maybe for the first time more acutely, and there's therefore some changes in the way that people are spending their discretionary income. But absolutely, I think that we should be doing everything that we can at the moment to ease as much of that pressure as possible. Mm. And what I think I'm also hearing a lot from our listeners is that there seems to be an even greater divide. There are a lot of people who are weathering this storm without really very much impact at all, and then there are others who are really doing it tough.